This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. American Victory Treaty of Paris, U.S. Protectorate over Cuba 1899-1902, followed by Proclamation of Independent Cuban Republic 1902, subsequent outbreak of the Philippine-American War 1899-1902, generation of 98 among Spanish intellectuals. Spain sells its remaining Pacific islands to Germany. Territorial changes. Spain relinquishes sovereignty over Cuba, cedes Puerto Rico, Guam, and the Philippine Islands to the United States for $20 million. Belligerents. United States. Guam, Philippines, Puerto Rico. Commanders and leaders: William McKinley, Nelson A. Miles, Theodore Roosevelt, William R. Shafter, George Dewey, William Sampson, Wesley Merritt, Joseph Wheeler, Maximo Gomez, Demetrio Castillo, Dueñi Emilio Aguinaldo, Apolinario Mabini, Maria Cristina. Praxedes: Sagasta, Patricio Montoyo, Pascual Cervera, Arsenio Liners, Manuel Macias, Ramon Blanco, Antero Ruben, Valeriano Weiler, Fermin Jardine. Strength: Cuban Republic, 30,000 irregulars, 19 United States, 379,000 regulars and volunteers, 22 Philippine Republic, 60,000 Spanish Army, 278,447 regulars and militia, 20 Cuba. 10,005 regulars and militia, 20 Puerto Rico, 51,331 regulars and militia, 20 Philippines. Casualties and losses: Cuban Republic, 10,665 dead, 20 United States, 2,910 dead, 345 from Combat Army, 280 Navy, 16 other, 49 2,565 from disease, 1,577 wounded Army, 1,509 Navy, 68 Philippine Republic, 30 killed, 67 Spanish Navy, 560 dead, 300-400 wounded, 67 Spanish Army, 3,000 dead or wounded, 6,700 captured, Philippines 13,000 diseased, 10,000 dead from combat, 50,000 dead from disease. Cuba v. Spanish-American War. Atlantic Ocean Theater. Cuba, Puerto Rico. Pacific Ocean Theater. The Philippines. Guam v. Banana Wars. Cuba, First U.S. Occupation 1898-1902, Second U.S. Occupation 1906-1909, Negro Rebellion 1912, Sugar Intervention 1917-1922, Puerto Rico, Puerto Rican Campaign 1898, Honduras 1903-1925, Nicaragua 1912-1933, Granada, Masaya, Coyoteep Hill 1926-1927, Civil War, La Paz, Centro Acatal, San Fernando, Santa Clara, Telpaneca, Zapotillo, First Las Cruces, Second Las Cruces, Quilali, El Bramadero, La Flor, Equefa, Agua Carta, El Sauce, Mexico 1914, Veracruz, Haiti 1915-1934, Fort Dipati, Fort Riviere, First Port-au-Prince, Second Port-au-Prince, Dominican Republic 1916-1924, Santo Domingo, Guayacanas, San Francisco de Macorís. Part of a series on the history of Cuba. Governorate of Cuba 1511-1519, Viceroyalty of New Spain 1535-1821, Captaincy General of Cuba 1607-1898, Cuban War of Independence, Spanish-American War, Treaty of Paris, U.S. Military Government 1898-1902, Republic of Cuba 1902-1909, 1959 Cuban Pacification 1906-1909. Negro Rebellion 1912, Sugar Intervention 1917-1922, Cuban Revolution 1953-1959, Republic of Cuba 1959, Bay of Pigs Invasion, Cuban Missile Crisis, Intervention in Angola, Special Period, Cuban Thaw. Timeline. Topical Military History. Cuba Portal v. The Spanish-American War. Spanish, Guerra Hispano-Estadounidense or Guerra Hispano-Americana, was a conflict fought between Spain and the United States in 1898. Hostilities began in the aftermath of the internal explosion of the USS Maine in Havana Harbor, leading to American intervention in the Cuban War of Independence. American acquisition of Spain's Pacific possessions led to its involvement in the Philippine Revolution and ultimately in the Philippine-American War. Revolts had been occurring for some years in Cuba against Spanish rule, which the U.S. later backed upon entering the Spanish-American War. There had been war scares before, as in the Virginius Affair in 1873. In the late 1890s, U.S. public opinion was agitated by anti-Spanish propaganda led by journalists such as Joseph Joseph Pulitzer and William Randolph Hearst, which used yellow journalism to call for war. However, the Hearst and Pulitzer papers were circulated among the working class in New York City and did not reach a national audience. Historians of the 1930s blamed them for stirring up a war frenzy, but more recent scholars have not accepted that theory. The U.S. Navy battleship Maine was mysteriously sunk in Havana Harbor. Political pressures from the Democratic Party pushed the administration of Republican President William McKinley into a war that he had wished to avoid. Spain promised time and time again that it would reform, but never delivered. The United States sent an ultimatum to Spain demanding that it surrender control of Cuba. First, Madrid declared war, then Washington followed suit. The main issue was Cuban independence. The 10-week war was fought in both the Caribbean and the Pacific. U.S. naval power proved decisive, allowing expeditionary forces to disembark in Cuba. Against a Spanish garrison already facing nationwide Cuban insurgent attacks and further wasted by yellow fever, numerically superior Cuban, Philippine, and U.S. forces obtained the surrender of Santiago de Cuba and Manila despite the good performance of some Spanish infantry units and fierce fighting for positions such as San Juan Hill. Madrid sued for peace with two obsolete Spanish squadrons sunk in Santiago de Cuba and Manila Bay and a third, more modern fleet recalled home to protect the Spanish coasts. The result was the 1898 Treaty of Paris, negotiated on terms favorable to the U.S., which allowed it temporary control of Cuba and ceded ownership of Puerto Rico, Guam, and the Philippine Islands. The cession of the Philippines involved payment of $20 million $569,840,000 today to Spain by the U.S. to cover infrastructure owned by Spain. The defeat and collapse of the Spanish Empire was a profound shock to Spain's national psyche, and provoked a thorough philosophical and artistic revaluation of Spanish society known as the Generation of 98. The United States gained several island possessions spanning the globe and a rancorous new debate over the wisdom of expansionism. The war began exactly 52 years after the beginning of the Mexican-American War. It was one of only five U.S. wars against a total of 11 sovereign states to have been formally declared by Congress. Contents. 1. Historical background. 11. Spain's attitude towards its colonies. 12. American interest in the Caribbean. 2. Path to war. 21. Cuban struggle for independence. 22. Spanish attitude. 23. U.S. response. 24. USS Maine. 25. Declaring war. 26. Alternative historical interpretations. 3. Pacific Theater. 31. Philippines. 32. Guam. 4. Caribbean Theater. 41. Cuba. 411. Cuban sentiment. 412. Land campaign. 413. Naval operations. 414. U.S. withdrawal. 42. Puerto Rico. 5. Making peace. 6. Aftermath. 61. Post-war American investment in Puerto Rico. 7. In film and television. 8. Military decorations. 81. United States. 82. Other countries. 9. See also. 10. Notes. 101. Footnotes. 102. Source citations. 11. References. 12. Further reading. 13. External links. 131. Media. 132. Reference materials. 133. Newspapers. Historical background. Spain's attitude towards its colonies. The combined problems arising from the Peninsular War 1807-1814, the loss of most of its colonies in the Americas in the early 19th century, Spanish-American Wars of Independence, and three Carlist Wars 1832-1876 effected a new interpretation of Spain's remaining empire. Liberal Spanish elites like Antonio Canovas del Castillo and Emilio Castelar offered new interpretations of the concept of «empire» to dovetail with Spain's emerging nationalism. Canovas made clear in an address to the University of Madrid in 1882 his view of the Spanish nation as based on shared cultural and linguistic elements, on both sides of the Atlantic, that tied Spain's territories together. Canovas saw Spanish imperialism as markedly different in its methods and purposes of colonization from those of rival empires like the British or French. Spaniards regarded the spreading of civilization and Christianity as Spain's major objective and contribution to the New World. The concept of cultural unity bestowed special significance on Cuba, which had been Spanish for almost 400 years. As an integral part of the Spanish nation, the focus on preserving the empire would have negative consequences for Spain's national pride in the aftermath of the Spanish-American War. American interest in the Caribbean in 1823, U.S. President James Monroe enunciated the Monroe Doctrine, which stated that the United States would not tolerate further efforts by European governments to expand their colonial holdings in the Americas or to interfere with the newly independent states in the hemisphere. At the same time, it would respect the status of the existing European colonies before the American Civil War. Southern interests attempted to have the United States purchase Cuba and make it new slave territory. The proposal failed, and national attention shifted to the Civil War after the American Civil War and Cuba's 10 Years' War. U.S. businessmen began monopolizing the devalued sugar markets in Cuba in 1894. 90% of Cuba's total exports went to the United States, which also provided 40% of Cuba's imports. Cuba's total exports to the U.S. were almost 12 times larger than the export to her mother country, Spain. U.S. business interests indicated that while Spain still held political authority over Cuba, economic authority in Cuba, acting authority, was shifting to the U.S. The U.S. became interested in a canal either in Nicaragua, or in Panama, where the Panama Canal would eventually be built, and realized the need for naval protection. Captain Alfred Thayer Mahon was an especially influential theorist. His ideas were much admired by Theodore Roosevelt. As the U.S. rapidly built a powerful fleet in the 1890s, Roosevelt served as assistant Secretary of the Navy in 1897-98 and was an aggressive supporter of a war with Spain over Cuba. Meanwhile, the Cuba Libre movement, led by Cuban intellectual José Martí, had established offices in Florida and New York to buy and smuggle weapons. It mounted a large propaganda campaign to generate sympathy that would lead to official pressure on Spain. Protestant churches and democratic farmers were supportive, but business interests called on Washington to ignore them. Although Cuba attracted American attention, little note was made of the Philippines, Guam, or Puerto Rico. Historians note that there was little popular demand in the United States for an overseas colonial empire, though at this time the United Kingdom, France, Germany, and Japan were dramatically expanding their overseas holdings in Africa, Asia, and the Pacific. Path to War. Cuban struggle for independence. Main article: Cuban War of Independence. The first serious bid for Cuban independence, the 10 Years' War, erupted in 1868 and was subdued by the authorities a decade later. Neither the fighting nor the reforms in the Pact of Zanjan, February 1878, quelled the desire of some revolutionaries for wider autonomy and ultimately independence. One such revolutionary, José Martí, continued to promote Cuban financial and political autonomy in exile in early 1895. After years of organizing, Martí launched a three-pronged invasion of the island. The plan called for one group from Santo Domingo led by Máximo Gómez, one group from Costa Rica led by Antonio Maceo Grajales, and another from the United States, preemptively thwarted by U.S. officials in Florida, to land in different places on the island and provoke an uprising while their call for revolution, the Grito de Bear, was successful. The result was not the grand show of force Martí had expected, with a quick victory effectively lost. The revolutionaries settled in to fight a protracted guerrilla campaign. Antonio Canovas del Castillo, the architect of Spain's restoration constitution and the prime minister at the time, ordered General Arsenio Martínez Campos, a distinguished veteran of the war against the previous uprising in Cuba, to quell the revolt. Campos's reluctance to accept his new assignment and his method of containing the revolt to the province of Oriente earned him criticism in the Spanish press. The mounting pressure forced Canovas to replace General Campos with General Valeriano Weyler, a soldier who had experience in quelling rebellions in overseas provinces and the Spanish metropole. Weyler deprived the insurgency of weaponry, supplies, and assistance by ordering the residents of some Cuban districts to move to reconcentration areas near the military headquarters. This strategy was effective in slowing the spread of rebellion in the United States. This fueled the fire of anti-Spanish propaganda. In a political speech, President William McKinley used this to ram Spanish actions against armed rebels. He even said this was not civilized warfare but extermination. Spanish attitude. A Spanish satirical drawing published in La Campana de Gracia 1896 criticizing U.S. behavior regarding Cuba by Manuel Molinay. Upper text reads in Old Catalan, "Uncle Sam craving," and below, "to keep the island so it won't get lost." The Spanish government regarded Cuba as a province of Spain rather than a colony, and depended on it for prestige and trade, and as a training ground for the army. Prime Minister Antonio Canovas del Castillo announced that "the Spanish nation is disposed to sacrifice to the last peseta of its treasure and to the last drop of blood of the last Spaniard before consenting that anyone snatch from it even one piece of its territory." He had long dominated and stabilized Spanish politics. He was assassinated in 1897 by Italian anarchist Michele Angelillo, leaving a Spanish political system that was not stable and could not risk a blow to its prestige. U.S. response, the eruption of the Cuban Revolt, Weyler's measures, and the popular fury these events whipped up proved to be a boon to the newspaper industry in New York City, where Joseph Pulitzer of the New York World and William Randolph Hearst of the New York Journal recognized the potential for great headlines and stories that would sell copies. Both papers denounced Spain, but had little influence outside New York. American opinion generally saw Spain as a hopelessly backward power that was unable to deal fairly with Cuba. American Catholics were divided before the war began, but supported it enthusiastically once it started. The U.S. had important economic interests that were being harmed by the prolonged conflict and deepening uncertainty about the future of Cuba. Shipping firms that had relied heavily on trade with Cuba now suffered losses as the conflict continued unresolved. These firms pressed Congress and McKinley to seek an end to the revolt. Other American business concerns, specifically those who had invested in Cuban sugar, looked to the Spanish to restore order. Stability, not war, was the goal of both interests. How stability would be achieved would depend largely on the ability of Spain and the U.S. to work out their issues diplomatically. While tension increased among the Cubans and Spanish government, popular support of intervention began to spring up in the United States due to the emergence of the Cuba Libre movement and the fact that many Americans had drawn parallels between the American Revolution and the Cuban Revolt, seeing the Spanish government as the tyrannical colonial oppressor. Historian Luis Perez notes that the proposition of war in behalf of Cuban independence took hold immediately and held on thereafter. Such was the sense of the public mood. At the time, many poems and songs were written in the United States to express support of the Cuba Libre movement. President McKinley, well aware of the political complexity surrounding the conflict, wanted to end the revolt peacefully. In accordance with this policy, McKinley began to negotiate with the Spanish government, hoping that the negotiations would be able to end the yellow journalism in the United States, and therefore, end the loudest calls to go to war with Spain. An attempt was made to negotiate a peace before McKinley took office. However, the Spanish refused to take part in the negotiations. In 1897, McKinley appointed Stuart L. Woodford as the new minister to Spain, who again offered to negotiate a peace in October 1897. The Spanish government still refused the United States' offer to negotiate between the Spanish and the Cubans, but promised the U.S. it would give the Cubans more autonomy. However, with the election of a more liberal Spanish government in November, Spain began to change their policies in Cuba. First, the new Spanish government told the United States that it was willing to offer a change in the reconcentration policies, the main set of policies that was feeding yellow journalism in the United States, if the Cuban rebels agreed to a cessation of hostilities. This time the rebels refused the terms in hopes that continued conflict would lead to U.S. intervention and the creation of an independent Cuba. The liberal Spanish government also recalled the Spanish Governor General Valeriano Weyler from Cuba. This action alarmed many Cubans loyal to Spain. The Cubans loyal to Weyler began planning large demonstrations to take place when the next Governor General, Ramon Blanco, arrived in Cuba. U.S. Consul Fitzhugh Lee learned of these plans and sent a request to the U.S. State Department to send a U.S. warship to Cuba. This request led to the USS Maine being sent to Cuba while the Maine was docked in Havana. An explosion sank the ship, an event discussed in more detail in the next section. The sinking of the Maine was blamed on the Spanish and made the possibility of a negotiated peace very slim throughout the negotiation process. The major European powers, especially Britain, France, and Russia, generally supported the American position and urged Spain to give in. Spain repeatedly promised specific reforms that would pacify Cuba but failed to deliver. American patience ran out. USS Maine. Main article: USS Maine ACR-1. The sunken USS Maine in Havana Harbor. McKinley sent the USS Maine to Havana to ensure the safety of American citizens and interests, and to underscore the urgent need for reform. Naval forces were moved in position to attack simultaneously on several fronts if the war was not avoided. As Maine left Florida, a large part of the North Atlantic Squadron was moved to Key West and the Gulf of Mexico. Others were also moved just off the shore of Lisbon, and still others were moved to Hong Kong. At 9:40 on the evening of February 15, 1898, Maine sank in Havana Harbor after suffering a massive explosion. While McKinley urged patience and did not declare that Spain had caused the explosion, the deaths of 266 out of 355 sailors on board focused American attention. McKinley asked Congress to appropriate $50 million for defense, and Congress unanimously obliged. Most American leaders took the the position that the cause of the explosion was unknown, but public attention was now riveted on the situation and Spain could not find a diplomatic solution to avoid war. Spain appealed to the European powers, most of whom advised it to accept U.S. conditions for Cuba in order to avoid war. Germany urged a united European stand against the United States but took no action. The U.S. Navy's investigation, made public on March 28, concluded that the ship's powder magazines were ignited when an external explosion was set off under the ship's hull. This report poured fuel on popular indignation in the U.S., making the war inevitable. Spain's investigation came to the opposite conclusion. The explosion originated within the ship. Other investigations in later years came to various contradictory conclusions, but had no bearing on the coming of the war in 1974. Admiral Hyman George Rickover had his staff look at the documents and decided there was an internal explosion. A study commissioned by National Geographic magazine in 1999, using AIM computer modeling, stated that the explosion could have been caused by a mine, but no definitive evidence was found declaring war. Main article, propaganda of the Spanish-American War. United States Army Colonel Charles A. Wyckoff was the most senior U.S. military officer killed in the Spanish-American War after the Maine was destroyed. Newspaper publishers Hearst and Pulitzer decided citation needed that the Spanish were to blame, and they publicized this theory as fact in their New York City papers using sensationalistic and astonishing accounts of atrocities committed by the Spanish in Cuba by using headlines in their newspapers, such as Spanish Murderers and Remember the Maine. Their press exaggerated what was happening and how the Spanish were treating the Cuban prisoners. The stories were based on factual accounts, but most of the time, the articles that were published were embellished and written with incendiary language, causing emotional and often heated responses among readers. A common myth falsely states that when illustrator Frederick Remington said there was no war brewing in Cuba, Hearst responded, "You furnish the pictures and I'll furnish the war." This new yellow journalism was, however, uncommon outside New York City, and historians no longer consider it the major force shaping the national mood. Public opinion nationwide did demand immediate action, overwhelming the efforts of President McKinley, Speaker of the House Thomas Brackett Reed, and the business community to find a negotiated solution. A speech delivered by Republican Senator Redfield Proctor of Vermont on March 17, 1898 thoroughly analyzed the situation, concluding that war was the only answer. The speech helped provide one final push for the United States to declare war. 210 many in the business and religious communities which had until then opposed war, switched sides, leaving McKinley and Speaker Reed almost alone in their resistance to a war on April 11. McKinley ended his resistance and asked Congress for authority to send American troops to Cuba to end the Civil War there, knowing that Congress would force a war. The American transport ship Seneca, a chartered vessel that carried troops to Puerto Rico and Cuba on April 19, while Congress was considering joint resolutions supporting Cuban independence, Republican Senator Henry M. Teller of Colorado proposed the Teller Amendment to ensure that the U.S. would not establish permanent control over Cuba after the war. The amendment, disclaiming any intention to annex Cuba, passed the Senate 42-35. The House concurred the same day, 311-6. The amended resolution demanded Spanish withdrawal and authorized the president to use as much military force as he thought necessary to help Cuba gain independence from Spain. President McKinley signed the joint resolution on April 20, 1898, and the ultimatum was sent to Spain in response. Spain severed diplomatic relations with the United States on April 21 on the same day. The U.S. Navy began a blockade of Cuba. Spain declared war on April 23. On April 25, Congress declared that a state of war between the U.S. and Spain had existed since April 21, the day the blockade of Cuba had begun. Spanish vessels captured up to evening of May 1, 1898. The Navy was ready, but the Army was not well prepared for the war and made radical changes in plans and quickly purchased supplies in the spring of 1898. The strength of the regular U.S. Army was just 28,000 men. The army wanted 50,000 new men but received over 220,000, through volunteers and the mobilization of state National Guard units. Alternative historical interpretations. The Department of State of the United States of America summarizes the aftermath of the war for the Filipino people. After its defeat in the Spanish-American War of 1898, Spain ceded its long-standing colony of the Philippines to the United States in the Treaty of Paris on February 4, 1899, just 2 days before the U.S. U.S. Senate ratified the treaty, fighting broke out between American forces and Filipino nationalists led by Emilio Aguinaldo, who sought independence rather than a change in colonial rulers. The ensuing Philippine-American War lasted 3 years and resulted in the death of over 4,200 American and over 20,000 Filipino combatants. As many as 200,000 Filipino civilians died from violence, famine, and disease. In 1901, novelist Mark Twain wrote about the aftermath of the war for the Philippines: "We have robbed a trusting friend of his land and his liberty. We have invited clean young men to shoulder a discredited musket and do bandits' work under a flag which bandits have been accustomed to fear, not to follow. We have debauched America's honor and blackened her face before the world." In his War and Empire, Professor Paul Atwood of the University of Massachusetts Boston writes, "The Spanish-American War was fomented on outright lies and trumped-up accusations against the intended enemy. War fever in the general population never reached a critical temperature until the accidental sinking of the USS Maine was deliberately, and falsely, attributed to Spanish villainy. In a cryptic message, Senator Lodge wrote that there may be an explosion any day in Cuba which would settle a great many things. We have got a battleship in the harbor of Havana, and our fleet, which overmatches anything the Spanish have, is masked at the Dry Tortugas." In his autobiography, Theodore Roosevelt gave his views of the origins of the war: "Our own direct interests were great, because of the Cuban tobacco and sugar, and especially because of Cuba's relation to the projected Isthmian Canal, but even greater were our interests from the standpoint of humanity. It was our duty, even more from the standpoint of national honor than from the standpoint of national interest, to stop the devastation and destruction. Because of these considerations I favored war." Pacific Theater, Philippines. The Pacific Theater of the Spanish-American War. In the 333 years of Spanish rule, the Philippines developed from a small overseas colony governed from the Viceroyalty of New Spain to a land with modern elements in the cities. The Spanish-speaking middle classes of the 19th century were mostly educated in the liberal ideas coming from Europe. Among these ilustrados was the Filipino national hero José Rizal, who demanded larger reforms from the Spanish authorities. This movement eventually led to the Philippine Revolution against Spanish colonial rule. The revolution had been in a state of truce since the signing of the Pact of Biak na Bato in 1897, with revolutionary leaders having accepted exile outside of the country. The Battle of Manila Bay. The first battle between American and Spanish forces was at Manila Bay, where, on May 1, Commodore George Dewey, commanding the U.S. Navy's Asiatic Squadron aboard USS with only 9 wounded with the German seizure of Tsingtao in 1897, Dewey's squadron had become the only naval force in the Far East without a local base of its own, and was beset with coal and ammunition problems. Despite these problems, the Asiatic Squadron not only destroyed the Spanish fleet but also captured the harbor of Manila. Following Dewey's victory, Manila Bay was filled with the warships of Britain, Germany, France, and Japan. The German fleet of 8 ships, ostensibly in Philippine waters to protect German interests, acted provocatively, cutting in front of American ships, refusing to salute the United States flag according to customs of naval courtesy, taking soundings of the harbor, and landing supplies for the besieged Spanish. The Germans, with interests of their own, were eager to take advantage of whatever opportunities the conflict in the islands might afford. There was a fear at the time that the islands would become a German possession. The Americans called the bluff of the Germans, threatening conflict if the aggression continued, and the Germans backed down at the time. The Germans expected the confrontation in the Philippines to end in an American defeat, with the revolutionaries capturing Manila and leaving the Philippines ripe for German picking. Commodore Dewey transported Emilio Aguinaldo, a Filipino leader who had led rebellion against Spanish rule in the Philippines in 1896, from exile in Hong Kong to the Philippines to rally more Filipinos against the Spanish colonial government. By June, U.S. and Filipino forces had taken control of most of the islands, except for the walled city of Intramuros. On June 12, Aguinaldo proclaimed the independence of the Philippines on August 13, with American commanders unaware that a ceasefire had been signed between Spain and the U.S. on the previous day. American forces captured the city of Manila from the Spanish in the Battle of Manila. This battle marked the end of Filipino-American collaboration, as the American action of of preventing Filipino forces from entering the captured city of Manila was deeply resented by the Filipinos. This later led to the Philippine-American War, which would prove to be more deadly and costly than the Spanish-American War. Spanish prisoners of war in Manila. The U.S. had sent a force of some 11,000 ground troops to the Philippines. Armed conflict broke out between U.S. forces and the Filipinos when U.S. troops began to take the place of the Spanish in control of the country after the end of the war, resulting in the Philippine-American War. On August 14, 1899, the Sherman Commission recommended that the U.S. retain control of the Philippines, possibly granting independence in the future Guam. Main article, capture of Guam. On June 20, a U.S. fleet commanded by Captain Henry Glass, consisting of the protected cruiser
USS
Theodore Roosevelt, advocated intervention in Cuba, both for the Cuban people and to promote the Monroe Doctrine. While Assistant Secretary of the Navy, he placed the Navy on a wartime footing and prepared Dewey's Asiatic Squadron for battle. He also worked with Leonard Wood in convincing the Army to raise an all-volunteer regiment, the first U.S. volunteer cavalry. Wood was given command of the regiment that quickly became known as the Rough Riders. The Americans planned to capture the city of Santiago de Cuba to destroy Liner's army and Cervera's fleet. To reach Santiago, they had to pass through concentrated Spanish defenses in the San Juan Hills and a small town in El Caney. The American forces were aided in Cuba by the pro-independence rebels led by General Calixto Garcia. Cuban sentiment. For quite some time, the Cuban public believed the United States government to possibly hold the key to its independence, and even annexation was considered for a time, which historian Luis Perez explored in his book Cuba and the United States, Ties of Singular Intimacy. The Cubans harbored a great deal of discontent towards the Spanish government. Due to years of manipulation on the part of the Spanish, the prospect of getting the United States involved in the fight was considered by many Cubans as a step in the right direction. While the Cubans were wary of the United States' intentions, the overwhelming support from the American public provided the Cubans with some peace of mind, because they believed that the United States was committed to helping them achieve their independence. However, with the imposition of the Platt Amendment of 1903 after the war, as well as economic and military manipulation on the part of the United States, Cuban sentiment towards the United States became polarized, with many Cubans disappointed with continuing American interference. Land campaign from June 22 to 24, the 5th Army Corps under General William R. Shafter landed at Daiquiri and Siboney, east of Santiago, and established an American base of operations. A contingent of Spanish troops, having fought a skirmish with the Americans near Siboney on June 23, had retired to their lightly entrenched positions at Las Guasimas. An advance guard of U.S. forces under former Confederate General Joseph Wheeler ignored Cuban scouting parties and orders to proceed with caution. They caught up with and engaged the Spanish rearguard of about 2,000 soldiers led by General Antero Rubin, who effectively ambushed them. In the Battle of Las Guasimas on June 24, the battle ended indecisively in favor of Spain, and the Spanish left Las Guasimas on their planned retreat to Santiago. The U.S. Army employed Civil War-era skirmishers at the head of the advancing columns. 3 of 4 of the U.S. soldiers who had volunteered to act as skirmishers walking point at the head of the American column were killed, including Hamilton Fish II, grandson of Hamilton Fish, the Secretary of State under Ulysses S. Grant, and Captain Allen K. Capron, Jr., whom Theodore Roosevelt would describe as one of the finest natural leaders and soldiers he ever met. Only Oklahoma Territory Pawnee Indian, Tom Isbell, wounded 7 times, survived the Battle of Las Guasimas. Showed the U.S. that quick-thinking American soldiers would not stick to the linear tactics, which did not work effectively against Spanish troops who had learned the art of cover and concealment from their own struggle with Cuban insurgents, and never made the error of revealing their positions while on the defense. Americans advanced by rushes and stayed in the weeds so that they, too, were largely invisible to the Spaniards, who used untargeted volley fire to try to mass fires against the advancing Americans while some troops were hit. This technique was mostly a waste of bullets, as the Americans learned to duck as soon as they heard the Spanish word fire, fuego, yelled by the Spanish officers. Spanish troops were equipped with smokeless powder arms that also helped them to hide their positions while firing. Receiving the news of the surrender of Santiago, regular Spanish troops were mostly armed with modern charger-loaded 1893 7mm Spanish Mauser rifles and using smokeless powder. The high-speed 7x57mm Mauser round was termed the Spanish Hornet by the Americans because of the supersonic crack as it passed overhead. Other irregular troops were armed with Remington rolling block rifles in 43 Spanish using smokeless powder and brass jacketed bullets. U.S. regular infantry were armed with the 30-40 Krag Jorgensen, a bolt-action rifle with a complex rotating magazine. Both the U.S. regular cavalry and the volunteer cavalry used smokeless ammunition in later battles. State volunteers used the 45-70 Springfield, a single-shot black powder rifle, on July 1, a combined force of about 15,000 American troops in regular infantry and cavalry regiments, including all four of the Army's colored regiments, and volunteer regiments, among them Roosevelt and his Rough Riders, the 71st New York, the 2nd Massachusetts Infantry, and 1st North Carolina, and rebel Cuban forces attacked 1,270 entrenched Spaniards in dangerous Civil War-style frontal assaults at the Battle of El Caney and Battle of San Juan Hill outside of Santiago. More than 200 U.S. soldiers were killed and close to 1,200 wounded in the fighting. Thanks to the high rate of fire, the Spanish were able to put down range at the Americans. Supporting fire by Gatling guns was critical to the success of the assault. Cervera decided to escape Santiago. 2 days later, the Spanish forces at Guantanamo were so isolated by Marines and Cuban forces that they did not know that Santiago was under siege, and their forces in the northern part of the province could not break through Cuban lines. This was not true of the Escario relief column from Manzanillo, which fought its way past determined Cuban resistance but arrived too late to participate in the siege. After the battles of San Juan Hill and El Caney, the American advance halted Spanish troops. Successfully defended Fort Canosa, allowing them to stabilize their line and bar the entry to Santiago. The Americans and Cubans forcibly began a bloody, strangling siege of the city during the nights. Cuban troops dug successive series of trenches, raised parapets, toward the Spanish positions once completed. These parapets were occupied by U.S. soldiers, and a new set of excavations went forward. American troops, while suffering daily losses from Spanish fire, suffered far more casualties from heat exhaustion and mosquito-borne disease at the western approaches to the city. Cuban General Calixto Garcia began to encroach on the city, causing much panic and fear of reprisals among the Spanish forces. Naval operations. The Santiago Campaign 1898. Crewmen pose under the gun turrets of Iowa. In 1898, the major port of Santiago de Cuba was the main target of naval operations during the war. The U.S. fleet attacking Santiago needed shelter from the summer hurricane season. Guantanamo Bay, with its excellent harbor, was chosen. The 1898 invasion of Guantanamo Bay happened between June 6 and 10, with the first U.S. naval attack and subsequent successful landing of U.S. Marines with naval support. The Battle of Santiago de Cuba on July 3, was the largest naval engagement of the Spanish-American War and resulted in the destruction of the Spanish Caribbean Squadron also. Known as the Flota de Ultramar, in May, the fleet of Spanish Admiral Pascual Cervera y Tapete had been spotted by American forces in Santiago Harbor, where they had taken shelter for protection from sea attack. A two-month standoff between Spanish and American naval forces followed when the Spanish squadron finally attempted to leave the harbor on July 3. The American forces destroyed or grounded five of the six ships. Only one Spanish vessel, the new armored cruiser Cristobal Colon, survived, but her captain hauled down her flag and scuttled her when the Americans finally caught up with her. The 1,612 Spanish sailors who were captured, including Admiral Cervera, were sent to Seavey's Island at the Portsmouth Naval Shipyard in Kittery, Maine, where they were confined at Camp Long as prisoners of war from July 11 until mid-September. During the standoff, U.S. Assistant Naval Constructor, Lieutenant Richmond Pearson Hobson, had been ordered by Rear Admiral William T. Sampson to sink the Collier USS. Of concerned officers of the American Army chose Theodore Roosevelt to draft a request to Washington that it withdraw the Army, a request that paralleled a similar one from General Shafter, who described his force as an army of convalescents. By the time of his letter, 75% of the force in Cuba was unfit for service. On August 7, the American invasion force started to leave Cuba. The evacuation was not total. The U.S. Army kept the Black 9th U.S. Cavalry Regiment in Cuba to support the occupation. The logic was that their race and the fact that many black volunteers came from southern states would protect them from disease. This logic led to these soldiers being nicknamed immunes. Still, when the 9th left, 73 of its 984 soldiers had contracted the disease. Puerto Rico. Main article, Puerto Rican Campaign. Puerto Rican and Spanish troops in Guyama, Puerto Rico in May 1898. Lieutenant Henry H. Whitney of the United States 4th Artillery was sent to Puerto Rico on a reconnaissance mission, sponsored by the Army's Bureau of Military Intelligence. He provided maps and information on the Spanish military forces to the U.S. government prior to the invasion. The American offensive began on May 12, 1898, when a squadron of 12 U.S. ships commanded by Rear Admiral William T. Sampson of the United States Navy attacked the archipelago's capital, San Juan. Though the damage inflicted on the city was minimal, the Americans were able to establish a blockade in the city's harbor, San Juan Bay, on June 22. The cruiser Isabel II and the destroyer Terror delivered a Spanish counterattack, but were unable to break the blockade, and the Terror was damaged. The land offensive began on July 25, when 1,300 infantry soldiers led by Nelson A. Miles disembarked off the coast of Guanica. The first organized armed opposition occurred in Yauco in what became known as the Battle of Yauco. This encounter was followed by the Battle of Fajardo. The United States was able to seize control of Fajardo on August 1, but were forced to withdraw on August 5 after a group of 200 Puerto Rican Spanish soldiers led by Pedro del Pino gained control of the city. While most civilian inhabitants fled to a nearby lighthouse, the Americans encountered larger opposition during the Battle of Guayama, and as they advanced towards the main island's interior, they engaged in crossfire at Guamani River Bridge, Coamo and Silva Heights, and finally at the Battle of Osamonte. The battles were inconclusive as the Allied soldiers retreated. A battle in San German concluded in a similar fashion, with the Spanish retreating to Lares on August 9, 1898. American troops that were pursuing units retreating from Coamo encountered heavy resistance in Ibanito in a mountain known as Cerro Gervasio del Osamonte and retreated. After six of their soldiers were injured, they returned 3 days later, reinforced with artillery units, and attempted a surprise attack in the subsequent crossfire. Confused soldiers reported seeing Spanish reinforcements nearby, and five American officers were gravely injured, which prompted a retreat order. All military actions in Puerto Rico were suspended on August 13, after U.S. President William McKinley and French Ambassador Jules Cambon, acting on behalf of the Spanish government, signed an armistice whereby Spain relinquished its sovereignty over Puerto Rico, making peace. Jules Cambon, the French ambassador in the U.S., signing the Memorandum of Ratification on behalf of Spain, with defeats in Cuba and the Philippines, and both of its fleets destroyed. Spain sued for peace, and negotiations were opened between the two parties after the sickness and death of British consul Edward Henry Rawson Walker. American Admiral George Dewey requested the Belgian consul to Manila, Edouard André, to take Rawson Walker's place as intermediary with the Spanish government. Hostilities were halted on August 12, 1898, with the signing in Washington of a protocol of peace between the United States and Spain. After over 2 months of difficult negotiations, the formal peace treaty, the Treaty of Paris, was signed in Paris on December 10, 1898, and was ratified by the United States Senate on February 6, 1899.